Today, I'd like to welcome Dipti Tait to the podcast. Dipti is an author, a public speaker, a hypnotherapist, and she specializes in helping people with grief. Welcome to the call today, Dipti. How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you, Ben. Thank you for having me on. It's an honor to be here.
Well, why don't you tell us your journey and why is grief so important to you?
Well, interestingly enough, yes, I've written a book about grief and it's called Good Grief. But you know what? I didn't sit there in school and think, you know what? When I grow up, I want to be an author and I want to write about grief. It just did not happen that way. The book came about because I had my own experience of grief in a very kind of a short amount of time. So in my 20s, my father passed away from leukemia unexpectedly. And then in my 30s, my mum passed away from liver cancer. So I had a lot of kind of grief in my life and I didn't really know what to do with these feelings. So what started to happen is basically I started to write what I call now my grief diaries. And these were divided into sort of seven sections. So what I was noticing was I was feeling these overwhelming emotions. So, for example, guilt or sadness or loneliness. And when I felt one of those emotions, whenever it was, I would kind of outpour like a stream of consciousness, basically, into that diary. And that diary was called Loneliness, for example. Anyway, so then seven of these diaries just kind of became my little friends. And they really helped me through that whole grieving period. Now, I wasn't aware of grief as a thing, to be honest, at that point. I just didn't really know what was happening to me. I thought I was going mad very, very slowly. And then one day, as I was actually training to be a hypnotherapist, and we were doing a module on grief. And my tutor said something like, you know what, you can just get over grief if you know what you're doing. And I was a bit like, what do you mean just get over grief? How can you just get over it? You know, having kind of gone through it so deeply. But the interesting thing is he didn't actually mean it that clinically, but he kind of gave me a different perspective on how I could kind of go through what I knew and also apply what I was learning at the time for solution focused hypnotherapy and kind of put the two things together, even though they looked on the outside very poles apart, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So then through my solution focused work, I was able to take those grief diaries and I turned the diaries into this book. So that's where the book comes from.
Oh, I see. So is it focused on your own journey and your own story, or is it just like you used it as a framework and a basis for the book?
Well, both really. So it has my journey and my story in there to provide the reference for, I suppose, other people's experiences. But then it also gives people the way out and the solution. Now, I want to kind of put a caveat in. There is no quick way out of grief, to be honest. You know, you have to go through it to get out of it. So that's why I wanted the title to be Good Grief, because grief, even though it might feel very isolating and it might feel overwhelming and it might feel like your whole world has turned upside down and you don't know who you are anymore and you might be in the, you know, depths of despair and depression, there is actually some amazing positives that come out of it as well, and deep understandings. And that's what I was really fascinated in.
Give us an example of what you mean by that.
Well, you know, when you listen to like sort of pop stars, you know, and they're like, so I don't listen to Morrissey, but someone like Morrissey, for example, who, you know, has really kind of dark lyrics and, you know, is in kind of the depths of despair and, you know, the kind of the deepest well of, you know, kind of depression. But in that, those dark times is kind of where he writes his best lyrics. You know, there's that amazing creativity down there in that depth. So that's the sort of idea I'm interested in, is that you can, in states of extreme discomfort, you can find internal resources and strengths in yourself that you really didn't know you had. You know, when you're just ticking through life and bumbling through and, you know, everything's just going well, you're just kind of just going through the motions. You know, it's Groundhog Day. You're just kind of getting up, eating your breakfast, going to work, doing the same thing. But actually, when something hits you that is totally out of the blue and unexpected, that's where you kind of have to develop these skills or find some kind of navigational tools. And actually, when you tap into yourself, that's where the magic is, I think.
And what were some of the positives that you got out of your grief?
Well, having my parents both die, and I am an only child, I didn't have anybody else really in my immediate sort of family network. I mean, obviously, I've got cousins and aunties and uncles, but they're kind of like, you know, not related closely to me, if that makes sense. So I kind of felt like I was totally, totally plunged into this sense of aloneness, of I didn't have brothers and sisters to share this loss with. And of course, obviously, other people in my family or my friends or whatever were, you know, also sharing the loss of my parents, but not in the same way as I was. So I just kind of felt this emptiness inside of me. But because I was so, I suppose, so drawn into me and my center, I was able to tap into these amazing strengths, and I just didn't know I had them. For example, I was in a marriage for 15 years, and even though it wasn't an arranged marriage, I chose my husband. It wasn't like a traditional thing or anything. I wasn't very happy, but I didn't have the courage or the guts to say anything or do anything about it. But when my parents both passed away, I just kind of felt this almost like a liberation had taken place, where I was able to sort of move into who I really was and kind of give my own opinions and kind of be me. So I was able to leave my marriage, even though I had two children to kind of support as well. But we did it in a really beautiful way. I mean, I think in like, oh, what's it called? You know, like when they talk about like conscious uncoupling. Right. And it's like, that sounds like a really kind of like fluffy way of saying divorce.
It's a new age divorce, isn't it?
Yeah, new age divorce. That's kind of how it felt like to me. I was able to consciously uncouple, doing it with a sense of awareness and strength. And being Indian, you know, it's not really the done thing to divorce. It is not. It's really not. So I had a lot of challenges in that way to kind of get through. And I didn't, I felt like I didn't have to explain myself, and I didn't have to, you know, kind of hide it. I was able to kind of find these resources to do that. And I didn't have any support, no job and no finances at the time. I wasn't a hypnotherapist then. I was just starting to train. So I literally had nothing. I was really down there, you know. And I guess in a way, I didn't have anything really to lose. I had just stuff to gain. But, you know, looking back now, that was in 2010. So, you know, looking back now, I think, wow, how did I do that? You know, how did I even go about doing that, finding a new place to live? You know, I literally moved out of my own family home, and that's not the done thing either. So found a new place to live. You know, I kind of started to piece my life back together. I found a new career and I built a new business and kind of started to build a Dipti up again, you know. And that was kind of done all with me. You know, I began to see myself as my new parent, you know, because I didn't have any parents anymore. And I think that's the strength that I found personally.
How do you define grief? Is it easy to define?
It's not easy to define, but it's easy to kind of explain in feelings, I suppose, because it's like, it kind of feels like a kaleidoscope of a mixture of intense emotional overwhelm all at once, and then absolutely nothing. So it's like highly charged emotion, and then all of that emotion can literally leave you and you'll just be left with an emptiness, absolutely kind of devoid of everything. So it's so confusing.
I see.
Yeah.
Right. And what are the different kinds of life event that would be the trigger for grief? I imagine there's a broad range of different stuff.
Yeah, but lots of people don't realize this. And this is what I'm passionate about, you know, helping people realize is that people usually think of grief when a death has occurred, you know, and they normally think, oh, you know, who's died? And yes, of course, we grieve when people have died, but people don't realize that we can also grieve when relationships end. We can grieve leaving a job. We can grieve moving house even and location. So anything that we've loved or spent time and energy doing or, you know, being, if that kind of moves away or is lost, there is actually a hole is left in that place. And I call that hole grief. So it's interesting how it doesn't have to be death.
Is grief a kind of trauma, or is trauma different to grief?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I guess grief can be traumatic, you know, a lot of the time. If people don't know it, if people don't understand it, it can feel very traumatic because it's such a out of the blue thing that can happen. But that's why I'm sort of passionate about spreading the idea that grief is inextricably linked to our human experience, and it's happening, potentially happening to us all the time. So I guess with anything that changes that drastically, with any change, there can also be a level of trauma that's left behind, because essentially trauma is, I don't know how to cope with this change, perhaps, or I don't know what to do with these emotions because it's too overwhelming. So I have to shut down, you know. So I guess in a way, if you are prepared somehow with, I don't know, some tools and some skills, or even just an awareness that this is what you're going through and this is normal and it's you know, it's kind of okay to not be okay, then at least you have some kind of system in your mind to manage it, if that makes sense.
Yes, it does. I don't want you to reveal the entire contents of your book because I do want people to read it. But is there something you can say to us about how to sort of begin kind of the healing process of improving the situation?
Well, I suppose it's understanding in the first place, understanding literally how the mind and the body and the emotions connect together. And also recognizing that actually what we experience on the outside, you know, in the outside world, has a definite correlation to how we think and how we behave. So if something kind of changes so drastically on the outside, of course something's going to change on the inside. So it's about kind of having that awareness of the two are mapped and linked quite directly to each other. The interesting thing about grief, though, is that sometimes that's where the confusion can lie, because what can happen at the beginning of, I mean, say somebody does die and it's unexpected, then you can go into a really long period of shock, which is literally a kind of head under the duvet, you know, feeling. It's a protection. Shock is something that can really protect you from any other emotions that can come in. So you start to feel a little bit disassociated from your world and your, maybe your family or your job, or, you know, the things that kind of rooted you at that point. You just start to feel a bit numb to that, to everything. And it's kind of like that's the brain and the body trying to give you a bit of cotton wool padding, if that makes sense. So given I've just told you that grief is a highly charged emotional state, it can also be the absence of emotion and absence of everything.
And like then a numbing.
Yeah, yeah. And it almost feels like you've just been anesthetized from head to toe, really, inside and out. And that sense of disassociation can probably feel quite alienating to some people as well. So if you understand it, that it could be so up that end and then so up that end, it then can start to feel less alien, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see. I know you work with people as a hypnotherapist in person and over the internet as well. So if somebody came to you wanting help, what would the first place you'd start with them? Would you go straight into hypnotherapy, or would it depend what their situation was? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is the challenge with solution-focused work and working with grieving people, because the solution-focused model does what it says on the tin, really. It looks for a solution and it doesn't dwell in the problem. So, of course, when you ask somebody what their solution would be, they might say, well, I want that person to come back to life, you know, and clearly that's probably not going to happen. So it's not very useful to start off with solution-focused work when somebody is grieving, because that can feel like you're not really honouring the loss, or, you know, the thing that they've had to sort of move themselves away from. So solution-focused work isn't meant to talk about the problem. However, what I believe is that sometimes we have to be able to acknowledge the problem, but then not dwell in it. So we've got the problem kind of there, and we know it's there, but we're still helping the client look for a potential way forwards. So it's not about pretending the grief isn't around. It's about honouring it and kind of examining it, but in a very safe way.
So it's a bit of both then.
Yes, that's where it kind of used to sort of in my head was a bit of a challenge, because the model seemed so, I suppose, polarized. But I've now found my own way that works, you know, and I suppose that was because of experimentation with myself. I always use myself as an experiment. I am my own guinea pig, just because if I know it works on me, then, you know, I'm kind of good to go with everyone else.
Why did you choose to become a hypnotherapist as opposed to like a conventional sort of psychotherapist? I don't know all the different kinds, but
yeah.
Why did you make that decision? I mean, what's so good about hypnotherapy, I guess, is what I'm asking.
Oh my goodness, how long have we got, Ben?
As long as you want.
We're going to be here for hours and hours. No, hypnotherapy is incredible. I mean, not many people understand the amazing power of trance. Trance is one of those words that people kind of look at you like weirdly. You think, oh my God, what's she going to do to me? Turn me into like a chicken. You know, there's all that weird stuff going on with, you know, perhaps stage performance or whatever people have seen on TV. But actually, if I quickly explain what trance is, because I mainly have to do this at the beginning of every session I do anyway, because people have these myths and misconceptions of that word. So I'm most of the time explaining what it isn't rather than what it is.
Yeah.
So trance is basically another word for REM, and REM is rapid eye movement. You go into REM when you're going to sleep at night. And what your brain does in REM is it's basically emptying the metaphorical stress bucket inside the brain. So REM is also known as dream state. So when you're dreaming, what your brain is actually doing is it's taking events of the day or the week or whatever, and it's basically turning them from emotional events and converting them into narrative events. So it's almost like, imagine that your brain has got an emotional mind and then it's got an intellectual mind. So all of our stress, I've got my inverted comma fingers going on, all of our stress is basically sort of fed into our stress bucket, which lives in the emotional mind. And then when you're in REM or you're dreaming, what your brain is doing is it's taking those events out of the stress bucket, moving them over to the intellectual mind. So the intellectual mind can basically take away the emotion, so you're able to look for a solution. And then basically you're saving space in the emotional mind, because your intellectual mind is like the Google server and it's got loads of space in it. So you're not then, your stress bucket isn't full over and sort of spilling over. You've got space in there. And that's the amazing thing that happens in REM and dream. And so, for example, let's say you've had an argument with somebody and you go to bed. Your brain will be thinking about that as you're falling asleep. And then your memory system will go, right, okay, we'll take that emotional memory out of the bucket, we'll put it into the intellectual mind. Then in the morning, you wake up, it's not like you've got amnesia, you still remember that you've had the argument, but usually you don't feel so emotional about it. And also you've got a solution. So that happens at night as we go to sleep.
So your brain is sort of computing, like kind of problem solving while you're asleep.
Yeah, amazing. Right. So it's not only problem solving, it's emptying the stress bucket as well. So it's creating space. It's like a defrag that's going on in your brain at night. And that's an amazing system. So we've gone, oh, wow, that is a really good system to be in. So then they've gone, well, how can we make sure that we optimize that system for people? And they recognized that REM and the stress bucket emptying system is the same brainwave state activity as trance. So that's why solution focused, or any hypnotherapist actually, not just solution focused, but any hypnotherapist will put their client into trance. And people will say to me, oh, I don't know if I can go into trance. And I'll say, well, have you ever slept? Have you ever dreamt? Because if you've never slept or dreamt, then maybe you can't. But usually people have slept and they have dreamt. So everyone goes into trance, you know, at night. Anyway.
Yes.
So yeah, that's the benefit of trance and how trance is so, so powerful, because when you can put yourself into a trance state, then you're literally saving space in your brain and you're consolidating and defragging and doing all that really. So it's all good.
Right, I see. Now I realize you won't be able to talk specifically about clients because of confidentiality, but is there any particular kind of I don't want to say success stories, but is there any particular things that stand out, that stories you can tell us of people you've helped or something?
Well, I mean, there's so many different types of things that people would come in for. It's so varied. It sounds a bit like, you know, when you're doing a list on your website, it just sounds like you can cure everything or you can fix everything, and actually you can, because, you know, the thing is, if you think, well, I mean, okay, not everything, but there's pretty much quite a lot of stuff that we can deal with and help people with. But again, we have to kind of understand that the people have to be in the right mindset. There's actually a kind of hypno joke, and it's basically, how many hypnotherapists does it take to change a light bulb?
And?
And the answer is one, only if the light bulb wants to change.
Oh, right. I see.
So, you know, if the person is up for changing and to doing what they need to do, then hypnotherapy works brilliantly. And that just goes to show that nobody can be hypnotized against their will, you know, against their free will. So it's all about permission, really, and the client's willingness to change and their willingness to make the effort to kind of use the sessions, you know, in their way wisely, if that makes sense.
How long do you generally need to work with somebody? Because I know, like, some conventional forms of psychotherapy can just be, they can go on forever.
But within, it depends on what it is. So, like, for example, a smoking session would be 2 hours. It literally is that quick.
Just that's one session.
That's the quickest we can do stuff. So smoking is 2 hours. And then something like fears and phobias is generally 3 to 4 weeks. And then general levels of anxiety, panic, and that kind of thing, and the spectrum in between sort of anxiety and panic sort of disorder type stuff, is sort of about 6 to 8 weeks, 10 weeks maybe.
Oh, I see.
And depression is probably the longest, and that's about 12 weeks.
Oh, I see.
So within 3 months, actually, you're actually good.
So you'll help people with all those kind of things, not just, you don't just specialize in grief?
No, yes. Yeah, so I'm a general hypnotherapist. So grief just happens to be the book I've written. But yeah, actually, hypnotherapy, I see a huge wide range of people. And recently I've done a lot of hypnobirthing, and hypnobirthing is really, really exciting, because at the end of the day you get a baby out of it. And you've had, you know, a really lovely, the mother has had, and the father actually have had both a lovely experience. You know, it's definitely not a category for one born every minute. It's like, you know, the other way around. It's, you know, they come out feeling empowered and calm and in control, and then they invariably have really, really calm babies that sleep well. It is incredible.
So how does that work? Are you there during the birth, or do they prepare themselves by coming to you before they give birth?
Yes, I don't go to the birth. No, so they prepare themselves beforehand, you're right. And I give them audios to kind of support them through that preparation. And I do it with the birthing partner, which is usually the father and the mum. And so both of them are experiencing the hypnosis. So then obviously the birthing partner can then help the mum in that scenario. So they're kind of like a Dipti stand-in, really. So they're both kind of prepared equally.
Who are the people that you follow or read, or like, you know, your favorite books or people online?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So, I mean, I'm obviously a really big fan of hypnotherapists who are kind of leading the way. I'm really enjoying the work of people like James Tripp and Adam Eason. They're really kind of my sort of guru mentors in my head. And those two are mentalists, actually. And I'm really interested in how they sort of see the world in that sort of mentalism way.
So is that more like an entertainment kind of version of what you do?
Yes, but they're also therapists at the same time. So it's quite interesting to sort of combine the two sort of models together. I love Derren Brown, and he's one of my heroes. So I'm trying to think of if I've got any female heroines. I mean, I do kind of really, I just love people who are inspiring, you know, and that's kind of the sort of type of book I would read as well. And I'm a bit boring, really, because I don't really do things for pleasure. I do it all for work, because my work is my pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. I feel like I am a workaholic, but I love it. So it's not stressing me out. It generates, you know, kind of enthusiasm and energy in me.
Yes. And I noticed on your website, are you organising some kind of conference or some kind of event? Did I get that right?
Yeah, well, there's an NLP conference that's International NLP Conference that's happening in May.
Okay.
And that's in London. And basically, I've been asked to speak and demo there.
Oh.
So that's quite exciting. I'm doing a kind of a demonstration of free flow trance. Free flow trance is something that I have developed, I suppose, myself. I'm a hypnotherapist that doesn't read from language patterns, and I take my clients, I call them fingerprints, so linguistic fingerprints, actually. So I take my clients' linguistic fingerprints, and I'm able to, on the hop, turn their language into their own language pattern. So that's kind of one of my skills. So that's what I'm doing a demo on.
I don't quite understand. What do you mean by that?
So basically, have you ever been to a hypnotherapist?
Yes, I have, actually. I was interested in it when I was younger, quite a long time ago. I'm loosely familiar, yeah.
Okay, so when the hypnotherapist put you on the couch, they would have been perhaps reading you perhaps something from a script or a language pattern? So basically, those scripts and language patterns are obviously pre-written, formatted scripts that a traditional hypnotherapist would read to you, because that would be relevant to you. So what I do is and this came about because one time I forgot my scripts and I literally had to, you know, wing it, you know, and then I winged it or wung it or whatever. I wanged it so well. I thought, wow, I can do this. I'm not throwing my scripts away, but I can just kind of put my scripts to one side, and I can just use the client's words from the bit of the coaching session beforehand, before they get on the couch, and I can literally weave their own language pattern. So what I do is I kind of get the sense of what the client's asking for and, you know, how they hope to move forwards and what they hope to achieve. And so I call them fingerprints, but they're language fingerprints, obviously, because that, if you think about words, people are using their words and their words mean something to them. So every single word has some information attached to it. Why did they say that word and in that way? You know, that's kind of what I'm really passionate about, is like listening carefully to the language people use. And then I'm writing sort of bullet points down, really. And then I've only got a bullet point sheet in front of me. Then they get on the couch, but I'm able just to turn those bullet points into a free flow trance session. So what they get is a completely individually tailored session that I can't even replicate the next day because I've done it on the hop.
Does that make sense? So you kind of improvise it like a rap battle, but you're sort of hypnotherapy.
Hypno rap.
I see. Yeah. So I guess you talk to them a bit first and get the keywords and then do the hypnosis, do you?
Exactly. Yes. And the language patterns are the hypnosis part. So, you know, you're just kind of weaving all of that in to their own language.
who's the instigator behind the event? Who's putting it on?
I think it is just called NLP International Conference. It's a big, huge international, you know, it's the biggest UK NLP conference. And so, yeah, that's really exciting.
Yeah.
I was thinking maybe they don't have enough speakers. Is that why they asked me? but then I'm hoping also I've applied to be a presenter and a speaker at the UK Hypnosis Convention. And that is happening in November, so the end of the year. And that's obviously a really big one. So fingers and toes crossed.
Public speaking is something that interests you. You clearly are drawn to doing that.
Yeah, me and a stage, we belong together. So you know, that's, I'm kind of one of these people that, you know, I get a lot of people who come in and have this kind of fear of public speaking. You know, even just in just the office, you know, when they have to do a meeting or something. And, you know, I kind of look at them and I think, wow, because I really don't have that at all. I just can't imagine being fearful of public speaking because I've always been on a stage since I was little. So that's my home, I guess. It feels like home to me. Get me a camera, get me a stage and get me an audience and I'm happy.
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting how some people are perfectly comfortable or prefer to actually get attention and have eyes on them, isn't it? And then some people that are opposite, they can't think of anything worse.
Yeah. My boyfriend calls me shameless. So so I'm like, yeah, is that actually, is that meant to be the opposite of, is that an insult?
Yeah, right.
Because actually I take it as a compliment.
do you have specific sort of goals that are real clear for the next 10 years, or are you sort of taking it one step at a time and letting the path unfold?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Is goal setting my thing? Well, I think I kind of have a loose goal or a loose vision of my direction, but I'm really, really happy to take, you know, a different journey if that happens to come my way. But I guess what happens with me is I know my purpose. You know, I have a really good sense of mission, you know, what I'm doing and why it's important to me. So if anything comes my way that doesn't kind of match up with that goal or that mission or that purpose statement, then I won't do it because it's not moving towards that, you know, kind of vision that I have for myself. But I'm not completely fixed in how I want to get there. I'm kind of, you know, quite flowy in that way.
Yes, I'm a little bit of both as well. I'm kind of, I'm semi goal orientated and semi sort of intuition orientated.
Yes. Does it feel right at this moment? Or does this direction feel like it's a good direction to go in because it's going to still lead me to that, you know? It's kind of like going on the motorway and then taking that junction and going down the country lane for a little while and then coming back on the motorway again. You know, that's how it feels.
Yeah. Some people are very like one or the other, aren't they? Like sometimes if you ask somebody what their goals are, they just look at you like, you know, speaking a foreign language. Like,
I don't know what I'm doing tomorrow.
Yeah. But then some people like near, you know, they get anxious if they don't have a specific plan, you know.
Yeah, exactly. So it depends on your mindset and how you tick and what kind of motivates you, I guess. And as you say, everybody is different, aren't they? Mm. And some people like to have that kind of definite plan in place because it makes them feel secure, even though we know that actually we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. You know, that's an illusion. You know, the goal is actually an illusion. But it still makes them feel comfortable knowing that there is this, you know, plan. Anxiety doesn't like a plan, you see. So that's the quick way of getting rid of anxiety is make a plan and then anxiety seems to go away.
Yes, that does make sense. Yeah, when you know what you're doing tomorrow or next week or you've got, you know, some structure in place to look forward to, that, that does ease the anxiety, doesn't it?
Yeah, because I think anxiety is a way of your brain and body saying, oh, we don't know what we're doing now, you know.
Yeah.
We're kind of, you know, out of our depth or out of our comfort zone. Can you please put some kind of strategies in place?
Yeah, too much uncertainty, not enough certainty. Yeah.
Yeah.
As we get towards the end of the conversation, would you speak to perhaps somebody's listening and maybe there's somebody you could help but they're not really quite sure, they haven't actually made a decision in their mind that they need help, you know, maybe they're sort of, you know, yeah, just a bit divide, you know, speak to people that could be suffering from grief that you could perhaps help?
Yeah, and that's why I wrote the book, actually, because it was my way of offering some kind of support without them having to leave the house. You know, if that was something that they were upset about or, you know, they felt that they just wanted to stay in that kind of bubble for a little longer, at least they've got the book there. It's kind of like a bedside table friend, you know. So I always say to people, you know, get the book and you'll just find a place. You'll flick it open. You'll find something that will just kind of help you at that time, so you don't have to read it from cover to cover. It's something that I wrote so you could just pick it up and put it down, you know, so it's kind of there as your comfort blanket, really. And also I wrote it, even though there were 7 of those diaries, there was a lot of material and the book's really super skinny, so I had to cut so much out. And the reason why is because I realized people who are grieving haven't got the attention span. You know, they don't want to read a whole kind of encyclopedia of psychological babble. You know, they just need easy kind of, you know, John and Jane language, basically. Mm-hmm. So it's so easy and it's so kind of accessible. And that's why the book is so thin, because I didn't want it to be overwhelming in a time where they're already overwhelmed.
Mm, yes. So if somebody thinks they might want some help from you, what's their first step?
Well, I guess, you know, if it is grief related, get the book first, and you can kind of get a feel for me in the book, because it's like, you know, they are my words. That is how I speak, you know. So if they connected with the book, then they're definitely going to connect with me, and that'll be a good kind of measure, a yardstick. If it's other things, you know, the things that we talked about, maybe anxiety or panic or depression, all of insomnia, even if you're having a baby, you can get in touch with me via my website. And we've discussed that I don't only see people in the Cotswolds where my practice is. I do sessions online as well. And in fact, I was on the phone to Sydney this morning. So, I've got half my practice is international and half of it is UK based. So, yeah, so I can see you online wherever you are in the world on Zoom, and I can see you in the Cotswolds if you happen to live near me in my private practice.
That's a great way of doing it, isn't it? Just splitting it between the two.
Yeah, I mean, and that way then you open yourself up to the world, which is, you know, it's quite a big place.
Yeah, that's awesome. And your website is great as well. It's very slick and very clear and looks modern and fresh. So
Thank you. Which one are you talking? Which one? I've got two.
I'm talking about DiptyTait.com, I think.
Okay. So DiptyTait.com is the one where I sort of the international version of me, okay. With all my hypno resources that you can download and everything, my blog. And then the local practice to me is the Cotswoldpractice.com.
Okay.
So, yeah, both of those places. And you can find me on Twitter at Dipnotherapy as well.
Dipnotherapy,
if you're a tweeter.
Okay, well, I've got all your links and I'm going to put them all in the description so people can find you. And thanks so much for coming on the podcast today.
Oh, well, thank you so much for asking me. It's been lovely.
Good, yes. I've enjoyed our conversation. So enjoy the rest of your day. And
thank you.
All the best with the conferences.
Thank you so much, and I'll see you soon.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.